One little thing I neglected to mention, many of you saw these and you went, oh yeah, HPG's coasters. And yes, they are. And what I have done is I've actually taken the original coasters. So this is the original coaster and they're good, thick cardboard quality. But what I did was I threw a little bit of laminate on there. You can pick up laminate for cheap. And then you can use these over and over again. And we actually don't use them too much for actual coasters. I don't know, maybe you folks do, but what we like to do, especially with HPG's big games, it's not so big a deal with the A&A variety because they're a little smaller, but we like to line them up on the board or on the table somewhere, and then when, say, Germany's going, Britain knows that they're next. And that helps, especially when you got noobs, joining the crowd and they need to know, oh, I'm Italy, so I go after Britain, and right now it's Japan, so I got some time, right? And it's easy to look, so to look easy to see. And again, this is the 42 setup for the anniversary edition, right? So Japan does go first, then Russia. I mean, can you imagine if Germany got to go first? That might be it for the Ruskies. So, all right, we will be back instantly for you and in a little bit for me. All right, turn one is over, and we're just going to show you what happened here. We'll start in the Pacific. The Japanese Pacific Fleet left America alone and actually went after the Soviet Union. Of course, punched into China, as they are wont to do, and came down here and wiped out that small British fleet down here in 35 and didn't sustain any damage. They did have a tip battleship, which of course gets righted at the end of the round. They did have a bit of a setback here in Yunnan. They attacked, and Yunnan was left with just a fighter left, but the Japanese only had a fighter as well and decided not to pursue that struggle anymore. 3-on-4. So Japanese had some marginal success. You see the Soviets are going to lend a hand. And the Soviets here have bulked up here in Yakut, as they typically do. Over here in the Middle East, look at this. The Italians are already in the Middle East. Well, how did that happen? Well, we're going to tell you. The Germans came down with a transport and a tank and from France and used a couple of guys there and tried to get into Egypt. And they knocked it all the way down to a fighter. And then the Germans figured, we'll leave that for the Italians. But then the British decided to skedaddle and they left Egypt and Transjordan. Moved back to Persia with their Transjordan troops and flew their fighter all the way back to India and built a factory because there's no real Japanese ground threat anywhere, right? They've got a couple of transports up there, but they're way too far away. So Calcutta can build up to 3 units, as you can see, the three. So the British are going to try that, not so much Middle Earth because that's a G40 term. But that's where that is typically, and they're moving guys up slowly. They left their transport here for some boggling reason. We'll ask him when he comes back. Maybe just forgot. And oh, that brings up a point. Are you pretty forgiving of people when they forget to do things? We are with stuff like that. That has no bearing really, but we'll see. So the Germans, even though they brought down some air power and everything, really took it on the chin here in Egypt. So they'd lost 2 guys on the first round, so they decided just to back up. Over here on the Eastern Front, the Russians punched into Ukraine and had some good stuff left, so the Germans left them alone. Eastern Ukraine was taken, Belorussia was taken. So the Germans decided to go up here and they took Leningrad, they took Karelia, and took it with some force. Of course, at the expense of their center, which is undoubtedly going to fall. But they put everything, all their money, into ground units. So they built a bunch of tanks and a bunch of men, and they'll be using those to prosecute the war in round two. The British popped into northwestern Europe just to be British. And there you go. There's your Normandy landings about 2 years too soon. So I don't think they're going to be too successful. You have to wait for the Americans to come over. And unfortunately, they won't be coming over because, in a bit of a Hail Mary, a single U-boat went over here, sank the destroyer, and of course the two accompanying transports. Down here was a British destroyer and cruiser. They both got sunk by the fighter in France and by a U-boat. And that took about 10 rounds. It was unbelievable. Nobody was hitting anything. But then the destroyer and the bomber from Britain came down and finished off that U-boat. So that's pretty much it. I don't know if this is status quo for the 42 setup. We don't play it that often. China looks like it's in a world of hurt here. I guess they're hoping to at least have one guy added to their ranks next round. So we'll see what happens on round two of Axis and Allies 1942 in the anniversary edition. All right, round two is over and part of round three we forgot to film. So So we got Japan's third turn in, so we're on round three here. So we might as well start with the Pacific Theater. As you can see, the American fleet is gone. They all came down south and took care of the Solomons with some authority. And the Japanese responded by building a couple of subs up here and keeping a decent home fleet. And they're doing a good job because they're three away. And then they've got this fleet, which is nothing to sneeze at, and has a bunch of fighters, two more that can go on there. Oopsie. And they are also three away. So America could come in here and maybe liberate the Philippines or cause some kind of grief here, but they could be betwixt and between there. So gonna have to be careful that they don't kinda throw their sticks into the wind, as it were. The Japanese sent a couple transports up here and took some home country guys. You can see the home country has nothing in it right now. Just to bulk up that, because they built a factory last round there and built three tanks this round. They also moved into Burma and built a factory. They owned Burma. This is the 42 setup, in case you forgot. And so they've owned that since the beginning. Because the British have a factory here and are building, going to be building probably three tanks a turn here as well. So the Japanese have to be cognizant of that. But as we look through China, we see the Chinese are gone. They actually had three in here. The Japanese attacked with two men and all their planes and the bomber. And the Chinese, to their credit, got two hits, which took care of the infantry. So the Japanese couldn't take it over. And but that's it for China. Till next round, they should get two infantry placed on, but they'll do nothing during the round. The Russians, not really turtling, but they did build six guys in Moscow this round, and then they also built three tanks and a man down here in the Caucasus, because they're still making decent scratch. The Germans are definitely bulking up here in the north, and also they have some in the south. They were able to kick out the Brits there in northwestern Europe. And you'll also see that there's not much navy floating around here anymore. So the British had their fleet here in the English Channel. The Germans attacked. And the British had two transports, a battleship, and a cruiser. The Germans came in with their cruiser, a destroyer, the sub, and all their planes. And they destroyed them on the first round. They only needed three hits, of course. Destroyed them on the first round. And then had the sub and a cruiser and a destroyer still sitting there because the Germans actually elected to lose a plane when the British got one hit. But then the British sent the RAF and their bomber command here and wiped out the remnants. Of course, they couldn't take out the sub because there's no destroyer. Here in the Middle East, Transjordan switched hands here. The British had a small force in Persia, and with their fighter, were able to take out that. But then the Italians came back, had their bombards, and basically took it without much trouble at all. They did lose, I believe they lost one man in that one. Germans are sneaking into Africa with a couple of tanks. The British moved up here, or stayed there from last round. Looks like they're probably not long for this world. Italians built a transport and some stuff to help out. I think you put the tanks in the wrong spot. There we go. It's supposed to go there. And then we have, what else is going on here? Not much there. Not much going on. The Germans have gotten out of Scandinavia. But the Americans have started to bomb a little bit. They just took a couple last round, but every little bit helps. And they've also built up a little bit of a fleet here. A couple destroyers, of course, because the Germans continue to build their U-boats. And the Americans have enough to pull off Operation Torch, but not much more after that. And with the Italians having a battleship here, two cruisers, and a little bit of an air power there. They got their fighter. So we'll see how that goes. But the Italians, as we know, are wont to hold on to the Mediterranean for that +5 bonus, keep the Allied ships out. But sometimes you just can't fight it. But the Italians are doing all right. They've actually got their 13 bucks, and then they've got 10 bucks in bonuses because of the capture of Transjordan and Egypt. And, yeah, they're doing okay. So, and France, of course, those three give them a +5 bonus. All right, so that's the end of round two, and just sneaking into round three here. We'll let you know how the rest of round three goes in just a moment. All right, turn three is done, and we're going to see what all the different nations at war did. You can see the North Pacific still pretty empty. And the Americans came in and took New Guinea with everything they had, didn't lose anything. So they still got four units on this. The Japanese, as we know, still have their fleet there. They haven't done anything since the last little video update, of course, because we had already done their turn. The Chinese did get two men, because they do have four places. So they get one for every two, of course. The British came over and took Transjordan from the Italians, but unfortunately, the Italians were able to take it back, and with a bit more force this time. The British brought their fighter from Australia up to India and built three more tanks, so they still only have three though. Their transport is doing a sneaky move down south here, and it's out of range of anything that could wish to do it harm, so it's pretty safe, probably coming to Australia to maybe try to take back some of the money islands here if possible. But the British contingent here suffered quite the reverse, as it was destroyed by a couple of Panzer tank divisions who were operating in southern Africa. So we're really not mimicking history here at all with the Italians in Transjordan and the Germans in South Africa, but what can you do? Italians still get their bonuses and are sitting pretty. They built four tanks this turn, and they also took the eastern Ukraine, just to be cheeky. So if we look at the Russians, they are surrounded pretty badly here. They still have the Caucasus, of course, so they still have their two centers of production. But if this were the 1914, the Russian Revolution might be kicking in anytime soon here, because they're getting pretty surrounded. They did back off here in light of the Japanese tanks being built, and already two there. So those six men would not last long against that. And Germany built more fast units here, some more tanks to go ahead over there and probably take care of Russia. The Americans have come over and landed here in Great Britain, just with four units though, not a lot of punch there, but they brought guys over because the Brits built three transports, so there could be 10 units landing in Western Europe here on the next round, so the Germans need to be cognizant of that. And the Americans built another three transports with three men and three artillery ready to go. So this round here will be pretty telling. It's only going to be round four, but the Japanese are starting to be a real menace up north. Still not a lot of kick down here. I think their attention has been taken up by this, so good on the Allies. And the Brits, though, I think are not going to be doing any more foolhardy attacks, but they might surprise us. They might decide, nope, we're going to go back. Because every time the Italians have to come down here, they're not sending stuff towards Mother Russia. So maybe the Brits will do it. I guess we'll find out on... let's see, we've had one, two, three. I guess we're going to be going into turn four. All right, we'll let you know how it goes. All right. Well, John Cougar is singing Hurts So Good, and it really doesn't. So Japan, sneaking up here at the end of round four, and have moved down here as well. They haven't, they've just kind of bulked it up with some more fighters and a battleship. The British, though, in a cheeky move, were able to come over here and take the East Indies with two infantry against one infantry, and they actually got a hit, but the Japanese did as well, hence the single infantry battalion. Japanese built a couple of tanks here at their shiny new factory. The Russians pushed into Yunnan, which was empty, so it wasn't much of a push, more of a stroll. Japanese built some more tanks up here and pushed these tanks over. So they're getting closer to Moscow. Down here in India, the Americans have shown up and have decided to put their efforts here in the middle to hold on to this British territory, which may have fallen this next round, actually. The Japanese may have actually sacrificed everything just to stop that. The Germans, as we see, are free to roam in Africa. And the Italians, well, look at the Italians. They are having a lot of fun. They're busting out now with their tanks. And that's fun. The Russians did a big push up into Archangel and took care of all those German tanks and infantry. Lost a few guys at the same time, but they actually had five tanks and a couple of men left. And so the Germans said, well, we don't like that. So they came across with five tanks and two men. And some, or a few tanks, two men, and a few planes, three planes. The Russians got like six hits on the first round. It was pretty ugly. So the Germans had to retreat and, didn't do so well. Moved a tank up there to bolster it, but built a couple of men. The Russians had taken back some of this land. So the Italians came in, took eastern Ukraine, lost a tank doing it, but killed a couple units. Caucasus has fallen, and the Germans have a good stack of tanks there. I think it's 10 tanks. And the Russians, as you can see, it's pretty empty here. Well, of course, they'll bring in their stuff and kind of batten down the hatches and just wait for the inevitable German onslaught, which may or may not take place this turn. It might, but we'll see here. You can see a steady stream of Italian armor, though, as they have no natural predators where they are. But the British took northwestern Europe and the Americans landed there, guys. So Britain took a different tack, though. They also took Norway. So they could have landed two more units here, but they decided to just land a guy up in Norway and just to be annoying, give the Germans something to think about there. Built a bunch of men to go with their stuff. The Americans had to go up here. They didn't want to sit in this C zone because this C zone here is actually empty. C zone 8 is actually empty and didn't want to put their transports there even if they unload everything. A lone German plane could come out here and wipe them out. They didn't want to separate this because the Germans have a bomber, a fighter, and now they have four subs in within range of that territory. So. And actually, the fighter up here in Karelia can make it to the C-zone. So the Americans had to come in with all their stuff. So they went up north. The reason they didn't come south was because the Germans, in a very splendid move, a brilliant move, as the Brits would say, placed the U-boat down here. So they kind of stopped any soft landing there. But the Italians have also brought their guys over. And as we can see, it's still an Italian lake. However, with this development down here, there could be some movement into the Middle East, and then these German tanks will have something to shoot at. The Americans built a couple transports of men and transports and destroyers and a fighter, ostensibly to go on this carrier, we're assuming. And as we know, there's that force there, 6 units, which are now within range of Europe. So, round 4 is in the books. I think round 5 will be very telling. We'll see if Russia is able to hold on here. It's getting pretty grim for them. And we'll see what they can do here on the rest, well, all of turn 5. All right, well, the Pacific is looking very orange these days. Alaska has been taken here in round 5, so the Americans had to spend considerable funds to bulk up San Francisco. And they should be able to hold on to it there. The British got a little cheeky and took the French Indochina here from them and got a $5 bonus because of it. Britain also sacrificed everything to punch down on the Burmese factory, and then the Americans brought in their meager forces to clean it up. But the Japanese have destroyed the American fleet and took 3 subs as losses, and that was it. And they wiped out two loaded carriers, battleship, cruiser, 2 destroyers, a couple transports. So that was a real, they got shellacked. And with the Japanese tanks here, they could take this back on their turn, no problem. They got air power. They could probably take both of these back, as a matter of fact. The Japanese are still moving north up here. The German assault on Moscow failed, and failed miserably. As we know, they are not in there, but they did take back some stuff around, and the Italians came back in and took eastern Ukraine again, and so things are looking pretty bleak here for the Russians. The British did take Scandinavia in its entirety now, well, except for Sweden, of course. Can't go into there. And the small contingent that had landed in northwestern Europe has been eradicated. There's a tank left in Britain. And you can see there's no navy here. Yes, it was all wiped out. And the Italians actually sortied their navy all the way over to 11. So they had a battleship, 2 cruisers, and 2 transports. Weren't loaded with anything, but because of a British or an American bomber that was up here, the Italians didn't want to leave it just hanging out there. But then 2 American destroyers that were parked here, plus the bomber from there and a fighter from here, came and attacked and were able to destroy it, and were left just with the destroyer. So the Italians have no navy, but they're making some pretty good scratch. They're making $27 a round. And again, if they hadn't gone out there, you know, they really have no natural enemies right now. There is a large American fleet up here, but it's all transports. But they are within range of Germany, so... well, not Germany proper, but France or northwestern Europe. But the consensus is that this is going to be an Axis victory. But we'll play it out here, round 6, and we'll see if Moscow can hold out. They've got a build coming. But they've got all 3 of the Axis are within range of their capital. So it could be just whittled down over time. We'll see what happens. They do have a couple of fighters in there and a few men. But Japan gets to go first, as we know, in this version. So the Japanese will probably assault this, take care of that. And then the Russians are going to have that, plus 6 more men. They have the money to put 6 men. They might be able to do 5 men in a tank, but we'll see what happens. And looking like an Axis victory, but you never know. Never know what happens. With this attack here, when the Germans went in with 14 units, I think. 17 units? Was it 17? Yeah. Anyway, they lost all but the bomber. On the first round, the bomber was all they had left. The Russians just shattered everything. So we'll see if lightning strikes twice here on round 6. All right, well, Kansas is gonna take us home on this one, folks. Dust in the wind And here we go. Let's see here. This is what's going on in the Pacific. It's the end of the game, folks. And the Axis have definitely won. Although the Allies are putting up a good fight here in Southeastern Asia. But it's just not going to happen for them. Africa is well in Axis hands. Italy is nothing to fear. The Germans are now able to spend money on U-boats, and the British have to respond, and they have about half the economy of the Germans, a little less than half actually, with the bonuses. But the big fun surprise is Italy was able to take Moscow. It was a tougher fight than everybody thought, because the Brits had the three fighters here that they flew in, and they took a toll, that's for sure. But just not quite enough. After the Germans hit them, and the Italians were able to come in and clean up the mess. And had the Russians even survived, they only had $6, and we got six German tanks coming in next round, so pretty much over. And no more RAF to come and bail everybody out too. So it's been a great game. Six rounds. So a good game. The Allies figured that they did not move quickly enough to get to Europe. I don't know. I thought they did okay. They just kind of got caught a couple of times with big fleet build-ups and got destroyed. I think the big problem was losing Africa early. That allowed Italy to just do what it wanted to do. So I think next game, whoever is here may build a factory and try to really keep it bulked up. All right, turn that down a bit. I like Kerry Livgren's voice, but just a little too noisy. All right, here we go. The Japanese, though, put a lot of money into subs later in the game, and it really paid off, especially when they had to take hits down here. They're just losing cheapo subs and trading aircraft carriers, so they did all right. The two factories, this helped out here, got them some tanks on the ground. Didn't make a huge difference in the game, but not too bad. This one down here didn't do a ton for them. I think it just attracted more attention, but it kept Britain pouring money into India. They had to every turn put $15 worth of tanks into there. They could have gone with men, but then the men aren't any sort of a offensive threat, so the Japanese could relax over here. So I think the Brits wanted to keep some pressure on the Japanese, in spirit anyway. So, but thanks so much for watching, folks. We really appreciate it. We're doing this over our Christmas holidays. We'll be headed back to school in about a week and a bit. But if you're on holidays as well, folks, hey, enjoy yourselves. Have a great time with family and friends. I had actually a really neat experience yesterday. One of my subs picked up the Global War 1939 game. That's the this one here. Picked up this, but he's a younger fella. I'm not sure exactly how old, but he's a younger fella, and his folks were cool enough to actually get the game for him and set it up and play with him. So I thought that was awesome. So Cameron, if you're listening, I hope you did well there as the Axis. I know you took Paris on round one. That was awesome, and I hope things worked out for you. And hey, thank your folks for playing with you. That's good parents there. So, but to everybody else, thanks so much for watching. And I just pray that things are going well for you these days. And just remember to hug your loved ones. Thank your friends for just being your friends. And may those dice be with you.